I'm doing a draft sim as we speak.
Oh, I that's why you weren't paying attention to me. You knew I figured you knew there was something going on.
I was listening. I can do both at once. But now, all of a sudden, in the second round, after I took Noah Fant in the first, which, ooh, that'd be quite the good pick. But now in the second round, here's Justin Layne from Michigan State. And I did an article at our website, scorenorth.com, where I looked at the specifications for the cornerbacks who are coming out and the ones that might fit. Justin Layne for Michigan State is one of those guys that is big and long and fast. He's one of the elite athletes in the draft and has a lot of similar tendencies to Xavier Rhodes and Trey Wayans. But this is just the domino effect of this Holton Hill thing. But you also have, in my draft sim right now in the second round, Paris Campbell, Deebo Samuel. These guys are really good receiver prospects. If I don't draft an offensive lineman in the first round, then I have to take one in the second. And the best one there is Caleb McGarry right now in the second, because there was a run on offensive linemen. This gets very tricky.
Happens?
I think it's first time ever.
Oh, man, I never saw that coming.
So now let's see. Let's see how this goes. If I don't draft a lineman, can you imagine?
Well, that's my thing. If you're getting Noah Fant in the first round, and then you look to the second round for an offensive lineman, where do you address the corner?
Well, I just took Justin Layne because he's the best player on the board.
But if you're taking a tight end with your first round pick, you're not addressing the offensive line till the third round?
I know.
I think Hubbard Broadcasting would blow up. Honestly, I think this building would just spontaneously combust if you were running the draft from here on April 25th.
You know what? Things changed. Last week, you were on the top of the world with your drafts, and people were naming you general manager. But this is why it's harder than you think.
It's very hard.
When
your second-year corner has an issue and gets himself suspended for it. I mean, he put them in a huge bind, and you mentioned that domino effect. I'm going to be curious to see how far this pushes back them going after an interior defensive lineman, because you're thinking about things that
that's like off the table now, isn't
it? Yeah, that to me is, I wouldn't call it a luxury pick, but that's a depth pick right there. That's a fourth round pick right now. If you're looking at where you have to address cornerback above that pushes, you know, a defensive tackle to the fourth round at minimum, in my opinion, because you still need an offensive lineman. You need a pass catcher of some sort and you need a corner.
Okay. What would you think of this though?
Okay.
Like, cause I don't hate it. I don't hate it because there's just too many holes. There's too many holes to fill with three rounds. And the way I look at it is anything past the third round, that person is not starting for you. It's very, very rare.
That's why you give guys a fourth round grade, because it's inconclusive.
Right.
You just don't know.
So every once in a while you have a Stephon Diggs who is in the fifth round and becomes a starter and good in 2015, but it usually doesn't happen. So I usually do three or four rounds on my draft sims, and we'll get to a seven round when we get a little closer, trust me. So I took Noah Fant, Justin Layne, the corner for Michigan State, who might as well be like a Xavier Rhodes or Trey Wayne's clone in terms of the body, tall, long, you know, all that stuff. And Connor McGovern, the interior offensive lineman from Penn State in the third round. Now, the Vikings, there is recent history with them drafting in the third round for an interior offensive lineman and having that person make an impact right away in Pat Elflein. And even in the second round, it was at the very end of the second round, they got Brian O'Neill. And all things considered, he played fairly well starting at right tackle last year. If this happens, I do believe Vikings fans would be upset to an extent, to a degree. But if you're getting Noah Fant on the offensive line, then you have two tight ends. You could play a lot of two tight end sets. I think that helps you with the running and passing game. And I now see cornerback as, if you're not just drafting for this year, which we always have to remember that, like you're drafting really for the next 4 years, I think cornerback now becomes really important. It can't be the first round pick, but it has to be second or third. And if you're getting a guy of that caliber, I think you'd have to be okay with it, even though people would freak the hell out.
Yeah. And I mean, rightfully so, because I just don't think you can hedge as much as they've done in previous years that you're going to be able to land a Pat Elflein in the third round or land a Brian O'Neill in the second round when you have such a glaring need on the offensive line. Yes, they signed Josh Klein. Yes, they signed Dakota Dozier. Like, they've got bodies right now and they need to add more bodies, but they need more of a sure thing than camp bodies, in my opinion. And I'm doing a draft sim right now. I actually need to pick my third round pick, but
you were also doing a draft sim while talking
on the air? You inspired me, but like I'm struggling now because I'm looking at this And I decided to go.
Oh, the GM is struggling?
Yeah. It's a hard day. It's a hard job. This is not a job that just anybody can do.
This all of a sudden got to be like, okay, you get your offensive linemen, you get to that second round, you're like, I don't know anything. Is there a tight end still around? Sure. Is there a safety? You wanted safety. I'll give you a safety. But now, because of the suspension, it's
I just had to take JoJuan Williams from Vanderbilt in the third round. That's how I address my cornerback need. And that to me is that a sure thing? I don't know.
So you got a safety?
No, I got a cornerback. So, I mean, that.
Did you, though? Did you?
Maybe. What are you saying? You think he's more of a safety than he is a cornerback?
He's exactly J'Ron Kearse. He's 6'4", 210 pounds, and has really long arms and is strong, but runs a 4.64.
Could play a nickel.
So they've got two big nickels. This is what we'll do. This will be their creativity. Like all big nickels, actually. The whole defense is big nickels. They're all 6'4 and 210 pounds.
That'll be the new nickname for the defense, dude.
The big nickel.
The big nickel.
The big nickel. And then in parentheses with an S.
Well, I just think that this really is going to test what Mike Zimmer does and how creative he gets just with like these hybrid positions, especially with his safeties and just asking the responsibility. I mean, Harrison Smith already has a ton on his plate. He can play every position back there. But once they do add safety depth, because to me that's inevitable, they've got two other guys on the roster right now. What is Anthony Harris' position? What does his position become? Do we see J'Ron Kearse honestly taking on more of a nickel role? Because they seem to like that more than just on goal line packages, which is what it started out as.
I think he could play a little bit in that spot.
So I just think that, you know, they don't have bodies back there either to really mess around with.
You want a little conspiracy theory on cornerbacks in the Vikings?
I would love one.
So as we were talking just now, unprompted entirely, I take a peek at the mentions on Twitter.
Mm-hmm.
Minnesota Vikings main account with 1.3 million followers sends out at Matthew Coller identifies cornerbacks the Vikings could target in the draft that have similar athletic traits to their current group. The Vikings main account signing on to the cornerback idea with a picture of Trayvon Mullen, who is a 6'1" corner out of Clemson.
Sounds like that's some precarious timing we're dealing with here. It also could have been a scheduled tweet, but with your conspiracy theory here because I just, you know, the Holton Hill news has thrown off a lot of what they're doing. I'm not saying they're drafting a cornerback at 18. That's not happening.
No, I don't think so either.
But it is going to alter their draft strategy in some form or fashion because truly, if there is another undrafted college free agent like a Holton Hill, and after what you're dealing with this year, are you going to hedge your bets on a guy like that? I don't think